Father, we thank you for this wonderful day that you have given unto us. Lord, this day that we might be witnesses unto you, Lord, both of all that you said and did and all that you are in us today. Father, we thank you for the Holy Ghost. For Lord, there's no teacher that we need but he. Holy Spirit, we yield to you. We ask you, Lord, put a watch on our mouth, keep the door of our lips, that everything we say would be all about you. Everything that is you, everything that you do, everything that you say, all of your truth, all of your ways, everything that you have. Father, we thank you for the word that you've given unto us. Lord, we thank you that Jesus, you're our truth, you're our wisdom, you're our understanding. Everything is found in you. Lord, we thank you for this people that are so hungry for you. Lord, I ask you that you'd fill them up, not with mind thoughts that they can begin to think are so interesting, but Father, deepen their spirit and understanding of your word. Lord, that out of their belly would flow rivers of living water and it just be in agreement with your word and everything that they say and do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right. The book of James. Introductory. I think much of this, most of you know, but James is the half-brother of our Lord Jesus. That's who James is. It's not James the disciple, it's James the brother of Jesus. It's Mary and Joseph's son. I would guess he was the oldest. I don't really know that. Maybe somebody does. But he, the oldest besides Jesus. Because obviously Jesus was first. And there's James, and we know that he had a brother named Jude, and we know he had sisters as well. Because, I mean, it's not like Joseph and Mary stopped having kids. They had a bunch of them. And this James, as being the brother of Jesus, is known traditionally as James the Just, and was, by all evidence in the Word of God, the ruler of the church in Jerusalem. So he was the head pastor, shall we say, of the church in Jerusalem, ministering to the Jews in Jerusalem. Remember, the original church was all Jews. They weren't even certain about the Samaritans until Philip went down and preached to the Samaritans. But that was okay because Jesus had preached to the Samaritans, so that was acceptable. They weren't even certain about the Gentiles until Peter got told by God to go preach to the Gentiles in Cornelius' house, and the Gentiles got saved. So, I mean, early on, it was all Jews. And James was, by all evidence, the ruler of that church. And he was looked to as the one who was sort of like the arbiter of, are we going to go to the left, are we going to go to the right, or what are we going to believe? He's the one, not that he made up the statement, but he gave the statement that the church's judgment on dealing with the Gentiles on what they would have to do. He's the one that told Paul and Barnabas, here's what it is. Keep themselves from fornication, keep themselves from idols, and et cetera. They don't have to keep the law. But it's the Holy Ghost who gave the pronouncement, but it was James who delivered it, right?
Yeah.
So this is who he is. He is a minister to the people of Israel who are believers. That's who he is. And an incredible guy, I'm sure. His bones, I think, are buried in 5 different places. Depends on who you believe. No, it's kind of a joke because there's a lot of people that claim to have the bones of James the Just. Because if you go back in the Old Testament, remember Elisha's bones raised somebody from the dead when they threw the captain of the Syrian army in there and he raised from the dead? So it's not crazy to think that, you know, the bones of James the Just might raise somebody from the dead or the bones. So they used to build churches over bones and things like that. Then they, you know, they begin to worship these bones, which is wrong. It gets a little out of character, but it's funny because I think I've counted 5 different places that claim to have the bones of James the Just. So he's buried in 5 different places. That's just kind of funny. So that's who James is. Then he's going to tell us who he is. So it starts off in chapter 1, verse 1. He says, James, a servant of God. That's what he is. That's how he identifies himself. You know, Paul identifies himself, an apostle of Jesus Christ. James identifies himself in chapter 1, verse 1, a servant of God. That's who he is. And of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's a servant of the Lord Jesus. To the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. Now think about that for a minute. Who's he? Paul always writes to the saints. James is writing to the 12 tribes who are scattered abroad. And he says, greetings. Greeting. Here I am, I'm greeting you. Okay, then he jumps right in. He does not mess around at all. This book is rich in just stuff. There's not a lot of fluff to begin with. There's not a lot of, I'm so glad, I love you so much. He just jumps right in and says, now my brethren. So he's talking to his brethren. Count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptation. That is his premise. How do you live out, what you're going to find out in this book is how do you live out your life today in God? What do you do? He says, count it all joy when you enter into diverse temptations. Wow. Count it all joy. In every situation, no matter what's happening, count it all joy. So that's why we hear the pastors preaching. That's why we hear the men of God preaching. Joy, joy, joy. Sorrow is not a fruit of the Spirit. Over and over. James says it right here. It's just right in your face. Count it all joy. Doesn't matter what's happening. Doesn't matter how tired you are, how weary you are, how persecuted you are, how anything. Count it all joy. Begin to thank the Lord. Knowing this, that the trying of your faith works patience. Knowing that your faith is going to be tried, and then out of that trying is going to be patience. This is what you need. But let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. What does that sound like? The fullness of God in Christ. You want the fullness of God in Christ? Let the trying of your patience happen, and you basically keep it with joy. Okay? I mean, Paul, it's very parallel to what, the message is no different. Very parallel to what Paul says, very parallel to what Peter says. But what he's saying here is patience. When you, in patience, endure with joy, your faith is tried and strengthened, and it's going to be perfect and entire, and it's going to lack nothing. That's the goal. Peter said it, you know, when you are if you are in heaviness, if need be, you're in heaviness through manifold temptations. It's the same thing. It's going to happen. Why? Because God loves you so much. He sees the need that you have in your life. He's going to adjust it. He's going to change it. He's going to correct you. He's going to teach you. He's going to change you. He's going to do all of these things. So this is the premise of the entire book. Count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. Knowing this, that the trying of your faith works patience, and let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. Now, if any of you lack wisdom, how does that relate to what we just talked about? Because a lot of times when you're in diverse temptations, you aren't sure what's going on. You don't understand. Why is this happening? What's going on here? So if you lack wisdom, you're not sure, let him ask of God that gives to all men liberally and upbraids not. Ooh, that's interesting. And it shall be given him. You go to God and ask him for wisdom, he's not going to give you something less than wisdom. He's going to show you what you need. Biggest problem people have is they just don't receive it. Because often it's correction, saying, okay, you need to make this adjustment in your life. You need to stop doing that. And you go, well, I don't want to stop doing that. That must not be what he means. Or whatever might happen, right? Okay. So he says to you, count it all joy. Let patience have her perfect work, that your faith may be entire. And he tells you right here, if you have lack wisdom, go to God and ask him. And he will tell, he will give you wisdom. But ask in faith. Nothing wavering. For he that wavers is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. You've got to ask in faith. Everything in your life is faith. You got saved by faith. You stand in faith. You walk in faith. It's got to be in faith. What does faith begin with? He that comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Just like he's give you wisdom if you ask him. You have to have the relationship. This is why we preach so much about relationship. You have to have a relationship with God that you can turn to him and say, Father, help me. I'm in a mess. I've messed up. Their sorrow has filled my heart, and I know that's not right. Lord, I need joy. It's just as simple. Lord, give me wisdom. And then you begin to yield yourself to the Holy Ghost, and he give you joy. Where you seemingly was no joy, or where joy doesn't even make sense, and he'll fill you up. It's joy unspeakable, right? Well, anyway, I digress a bit, but what he says, you've got to ask in faith. You've got to know that God loves you and cares about you. You have to know that he is not going to turn you away, that when you ask him for a piece of bread, he does not give you a stone, that when you ask him for the Holy Ghost, he will give you the Holy Ghost. You have to know that. You have to ask him. Okay. So the man who wavers, who's uncertain, I don't know if God loves me, I'm not certain if God will answer me, I'm not certain what he's doing, I'm not certain if he even notices me. The man who wavers like the sea driven with the wind and tossed, don't let that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. Ay, ay, ay. That's kind of black and white. This is James's way. If you ask God, he gives to everybody liberally, doesn't upbraid. You ask wavering, you get nothing. There's no halfways. It's all or nothing. Wow. Nothing. I cried out to God, got nothing. What does that tell you? You need to ask in faith. You can't waver. I mean, it's what he's telling you. A double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. I don't want to be that. Lord, I don't want to be that. So then I have to grow in faith. How am I going to grow in faith? We go back to the beginning of the chapter. Let patience have her perfect work. Count it all joy. It's like the first thing you have to learn to do. You got to learn to be happy. You got to learn to be joyful. You got to learn to be excited. You got to learn to be praising. You got to learn to be worshiping. You got to be learned to going after that. That's how you start. You don't, anytime you find yourself wavering, you find yourself asking and seemingly nothing happens, what's the first thing to go back to? Joy. Where's joy found? First place joy is found? Salvation. Father, forgive me. I don't know what I've done, but Lord, I thank you that you're so merciful. And Lord, I love you so much, and I thank you for what Jesus did to take my sins away. I thank you for the blood that cleanses me from all sin. And guess what happens? Joy fill your heart. Even greater joy than the day you first got saved. That's good. All right. So first message, count it all joy. Second message, ask in faith, no wavering. Keep those in mind because you're going to see them come back. Verse 9, let the brother of low degree rejoice and he's exalted. So, you know, you're a lowly nobody, or you think you are, or somebody told you you were, rejoice because God exalts you. Isn't that wonderful?
Yeah.
The rich, you got lots of stuff, you never lacked for anything in your life. Here's what he tells you to do. Rejoice, he says, rejoice and he's exalted. He's saying rejoice again. Rejoice in that he's made low. Lord, I thank you for humbling me. I thank you for humility. Lord, I thank you that I can fall upon the rock and be broken so that someday you won't come and crush me to powder. Okay? This is it. This exalting this. Because as the flower of the grass, you're going to pass away. I don't care who you are. Richest man in the world, as the flower of the grass, you're going to pass away. For the sun is no sooner risen with a burning heat, but it withers the grass, and the flower thereof falls, and the grace of the fashion of it perishes. So also shall the rich man fade away in his ways. Wow. It's pretty intense. Blessed, you want to be blessed, is the man that endures temptation. Remember earlier it told you, what are you supposed to do to endure temptation? So it's going to remember, joy. If I'm in temptation and sorrow, something's wrong. Right? I got to get filled with joy. Because if I'm going to endure temptation, and you're blessed when you endure temptation. Overcomers, only overcomer will be with God. Only overcomer will live with God. You've got to be an overcomer. So you have to endure temptation. It's not endurance if you give in to it. You know, I'm going to endure giving in. No, I don't think that works. You have to endure by standing against it, right? For when you are tried, he shall receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to them that love him. There's one of those crowns you can have. like the martyr's crown. There's the crown of life. How do you get this one? Endure temptation. That's how you get it. Temptation comes. You've succumbed before. How do you begin to stand against it? Count it all joy. Lord, I thank you for an opportunity to stand against this ugly thing. It helps. It really helps. Because you've now pinned it. You've acknowledged it for what it is. You know, they always talk about in war, you're supposed to find the objective, get it static, and then crush it. That's what you do. And what you do when you recognize temptation for what it is, now you've got it. You know what it is. You've got it. You know where to hit. You know what to do. Now, what's your weapon? Joy. Father, thank you that you deliver me out of them all. Lord, I thank you that you strengthen me to endure temptation. Lord, I thank you that I can endure because you won't allow me to be tempted by what I'm able. All those Word of God scriptures come back to you and you begin to understand what it is that you can do to stand in this. Because a lot of times we just say, oh, endure temptation. Oh, it's so painful. It doesn't have to be painful to endure temptation. It can be rejoicing. In fact, it's supposed to be rejoicing. Because you see the enemy, he is coming against your walls and he's broken against them and he cannot pass through the shield of faith. Because you've stood in faith, believing God. He's powerful enough to deliver me out of them all. Even as he delivered Jesus out of them all. And you get strengthened. And in patience, you endure. Lord, why am I still dealing with this thing? Patience. Count it all joy. The Lord's bringing out something perfect and entire and full. This is what he's doing. Notice that all of this is that it's that faith thing. It's trusting God. That's what you're going to hear all through this. So he gives a crown of life to them that have loved him. So here's the beginning of the book. The first 13 verses is the whole beginning of the book, or first 12 or whatever it is. First beginning of the book. It's all about that one message. Now, we could preach about that one message out of the whole Bible for hours. Just this message. The message of joy to get you through temptation. The message of enduring temptation, letting patience have its perfect work, and the weapon of faith to stand against all the wickedness of the enemy. That message you could preach on and on and on and on and on. But James just did it. He does it very concisely. So then we're going to move on to message number two. That's what's about to happen. Verse 13. Now, we're going to give you some more information about temptation. Let no man say when he's tempted, I'm tempted of God. God does not tempt. God cannot be tempted with evil, and neither tempts he any man. It's never God tempting you. We would always say God allows temptation. He'll allow you to be tempted. But he'll never allow you to be tempted above what you're able to bear. Right? But every man is tempted when? When he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Every temptation. Something that you want, something that you think you need, something that you desire, something that you think would be good for you. You begin to be drawn away and enticed because you want this thing. As we often say, the devil tempts by taking that which God made holy and trying to use it for unholy purposes. God told us to covet the best spiritual gifts, but not to covet that which is our neighbor's. There's nothing wrong with having the ability to desire something. Nothing wrong with that. But inordinate desire for things that you are not supposed to have or that you cannot take, those can be tempted to use what God gave you inappropriately. It's the same thing with all the sexual immorality. There's nothing wrong in the proper context. Take it out of the proper context, it becomes evil. Okay? And that's why what he says here is that every man's tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. There are in us strong desires for things and for stuff. And when those become inordinate and when those are drawn away into things you're not supposed to have. Perfect example is in the garden. God said to them, every tree is given to you for food. Every single one of them. You have abundance of things to fulfill your desire. The way that it looks, the way that it feels, the way that it tastes. It's all there. They wanted the one they weren't supposed to have. It's all that they cared about at that moment. It's all that they were focused on that gave an opening to the devil to entice them. It was nothing wrong with desiring a piece of fruit. That's a good looking piece of fruit. I think I'll eat that. But God told you not to eat of that tree. Therefore, that natural desire to have a piece of fruit taken to the place of that tree becomes inordinate. And that's how all of these things happen. So you're enticed. Then when lust has conceived, it brings forth sin. This is why we'll often talk about the fact that the thought of sin is not sin. It's not, because Jesus was tempted. So Jesus could have been drawn away of his own strong desires, because he was tempted in all like manner as we. So if when we're tempted, it's when we're drawn away of our own desires or our own lust and enticed, so was Jesus. But it never conceived in him, because he endured every single temptation. He resisted every single one. He was anointed with the oil of joy above all his fellows. He was full of joy, and he with great joy and patience, he endured temptation. In a way that most of us have never done, go 40 days in the wilderness with nothing and be tempted of the devil. You know, I mean, that's enduring. There's a lot of endurance going on there. But he endured temptation. But when lust is conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it's finished, brings forth death. The wages of sin is death. So now we understand a bit more about how temptation works. Because then he repeats himself in a sense. Do not err, my beloved brother. Don't get this wrong. This is foundational to understanding how you walk with God. It's a big deal. Verse 17, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Of his own will begat he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. What are we supposed to do then? One of the most important things we're going to learn how to do is to endure temptation. And if you're going to endure temptation, you need to understand what it is, and you need to understand your weapons. So now, if we reiterate again, in order to endure temptation, you have to have the weapons of joy and the weapons of shield faith, right? We understand this is what we have. He's given us every good gift. They come from the Father. He's not the tempter. He's the one who gives us the good gifts. He gave us the joy. He gave us the faith. He gave us the weapons to endure temptation. He didn't give us the temptation. But he wants us to be patient as we go through it, enduring the temptation, so that our faith will be made perfect. We'll get better. It's just like training. I'm going to teach you how to use a sword and shield. None of us knows how to do that. We would all be complete dweebs trying to figure out how to use the thing. Some would figure out a better way than others. But you get somebody in here that's an expert on how to do it, and they start training you, we can start making us good. Well, who's an expert? Holy Ghost's an expert. He knows how to do this. All right. So you got that. This is important stuff. Wherefore, knowing all of this ahead, you remember I always say, if you see a wherefore or a therefore, you got to know what it's there for. It's there to say, knowing this, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. That's patience. Be really quick to be corrected, very slow to speak. Swift to hear. Hear the word of God. Hear the preaching of the gospel. Hear the message of correction, but very slow to speak, and certainly very slow to get angry. Don't want to do that. You're mistreating me again. Stop. Don't get angry. Don't be wrathful. Don't get upset. Very important stuff. Because this is part of this endure temptation thing. And it's a big part of it. Knowing this, knowing our understanding of the weapons we have to defend against it, knowing what it is and where it comes from. I mean, this is specific understanding of this particular thing. He says, knowing this, be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. Wow, okay, I'll do that. For the wrath of man does not work the righteousness of God. You getting angry doesn't really help much. Okay. Wherefore, another wherefore. Here's another thing that you're going to do. Knowing this, that I've got to endure temptation, right? Lay apart all filthiness, every unclean thing, set it apart. Say, I will not partake of the unclean thing. And superfluity of naughtiness. That's just another way of saying the really unclean stuff. And receive with meekness the engrafted word which is able to save your souls. So, swift to hear, that's meekness. Swift to hear, that's humility. That's brokenness. That's swift to hear. Slow to speak, he says here, I want to receive the engrafted word. The Lord's going to impart unto me the word. What we're hoping to do this morning is impart the word by the Holy Ghost so that it's in you. God already wrote it in your heart. But it's the Holy Ghost is doing his work to strengthen you in the word, right? And that meekness that's able to save your souls. You lay apart the unclean thing. Be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. Who preached that message? Jesus. It's not the hearer that's justified, it's the doer. That's what you want to be. It's not the one who heard the word, it's the one who heard the word and did it that's justified. Jesus preached that. James preaches it well. Be a doer of the word. So receive with meekness the engrafted word. So we've been talking about some things you can do. Joy. Faith. Ask God in faith. These are active commands of things that you can do to endure temptation. For if any man be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like a man behold his natural face in a glass. He beholds himself, goes his way, and straightway forgets what manner of man he was. So why this analogy? It's an interesting thing. So you're saying, I heard the word, but I didn't do it, is like looking in your glass and forgetting who you are. So then let's try to imagine how that works. Oh, I see. So when I look into the word, and I see the word describe me for what Jesus made me to be, and then I go away and act like I'm somebody who doesn't have these weapons to fight against it. I lose sight of who I am. I have to succumb. It's like people saying, well, everybody sins more or less every day. I have to fail because it's who I am. What? It's a wrong identity. Yeah. My identity needs to be the one the Word gave me. Yeah. I see what the Word said about me here. Yeah. And he's going to talk about that more. Okay? But whoso looks into the perfect law of liberty, that's the Word of God, and continues therein, not being a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man is blessed in his deed. So don't look into the word of God and then go out and fail to do it. Look into it, hear it, cry out to God, Lord, strengthen me in faith. I believe in you. I'm going to keep this word. I want this in my life. And go out and do it. Yeah. That's what you do. If any man among you seem to be religious, this is where everybody gets all their sermons on how religion is bad. And bridles not his tongue, but deceives his own heart, that man's religion is vain. So we're going to talk a bit more later. He's going to talk a lot about the tongue. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction. That's where most people stop. Right? Isn't that how you hear the word quoted all the time? Pure religion, undefiled, to visit the fathers and the widows in their affliction, right? That's what it is. Oh, wait, there's another clause. And to keep himself unspotted from the world. Lay aside all filthiness, all superfluity of naughtiness. Lay it all aside. Set that stuff aside. Reject it. Put it far away from you so that you can begin to be a doer of the word. That's what he tells you to do. You want pure religion? You want the pure? Keep yourself unspotted from the world. Yeah, go visit the fatherless in their affliction. Go visit the widows. Take care of the orphans and take care of those in need. Those are all good things. But you can go and pretend to do all of that, but if you don't keep yourself unspotted from the world, you don't have pure religion. Yeah. You just don't. So it's the first thing that you do. oh, I'm going to keep myself unspotted from the world. So we move on to chapter 2. We've now, that is all a whole. There's the first part, second part, third part. Chapter 1 tells you how to walk with God and makes it very clear as many other scriptures make it, that we are supposed to be unspotted from the world. That's what you're supposed to be. And tells you how to endure temptation. Okay? So we all are equipped now. We know how to do it. What's your first weapon? Some joy. What's your second weapon?
Faith.
Shield of faith. And asking God for wisdom. Right? That's it. Okay, chapter 2, verse 1. My brethren, now, we're talking about the faith thing again. We're going to emphasize your shield of faith. Have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect of persons. Like, have not the faith. How does that work? For if there come into your assembly a man with a gold ring in goodly apparel, and there come in also a poor man in vile raiment, and you have respect to him that wears the gay clothing, and say unto him, sit thou here in a good place, and say to the poor, stand thou there, or sit here under my footstool, are you not then partial in yourselves and become judges of evil thoughts? Wow. You're going to have the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ? No respect to persons allowed.
Yeah.
None. In fact, we're told very clearly in other places not to know any man after the flesh, but by the Spirit. So what if I give honor to a man of God who is going all over the world, preaching the gospel, miracles, signs, and wonders following, and I give honor to him? Is that okay? Yeah, it's okay. Spiritual honor. But we have no respect of persons. None. Because I'll spend all night praying for the one who's interested in receiving the gospel, receiving the glory, no matter who they are. There's no respect of persons in what you do. But that doesn't mean you can't honor things that you see God has done. I wanted to make that emphasis clear because, you know, people take these things and twist them all the time. Take these scriptures and they use them in the wrong way. Well, you know, why do you, you know, honor that man of God? Because he's a man of God. That's why I honor him. Is anything wrong with that? Well, that's respect the person. No, it's not. I'm not respecting this person. I'm respecting spiritually. I'm respecting the Holy Ghost. What the Holy Ghost is allowed to do and how the Holy Ghost is flowing through. That's what I'm respecting. That's okay. But we don't respect persons about their flesh. Oh, he's bigger, he's stronger, he's faster, he's smarter, he's what? No. He wears better clothing. Oh, he's got better manners. Nonsense. We don't respect persons that way. So we're not going to do that. We don't want to become judges of evil thoughts. What's a judge of evil thoughts? I mean, think about that. Who is the judge? Always back up a little bit. Who's the judge? The Father. Jesus is going to judge according to the gospel, according to his word. Right? They're judges. Am I the judge? Well, Jesus told me, judge not that you be not judged. Right? Yeah. Well, if the word of God tells me that, you know, murder is a sin, and somebody commits murder, the word of God has judged them already, have they not?
Yeah.
So we understand that we can see that and go, well, murder's wrong, right? So what are we talking about? Judge not, be not judges of evil thoughts. What is the point of this? It's the partiality that's the point. It's the receiving the bribe to change the judgment so that you help the one who gave you the gift that God hates. It's the judgment of your own mind against people because I don't like people with you know, whatever, nose tattoos or something, whatever it might be. And I'm going to judge people, and I'm going to begin to judge according to my judgment and the rules that I set and the things that I think are important. We're going to judge by the word of God only. So let's keep going because it's going to answer some of this. Verse 5, hearken, listen, my beloved brethren. Has not God chosen the poor of this world rich in faith? And heirs of the kingdom which he has promised to them that love him. Another place it says, not many mighty, not many rich men are called. not many great in this world? Why? Because we saw earlier how they're going to be in as the dust. They're going to be wiped out. So that he's in, it's not who he calls. He calls the poor and the lowly and the meek. Well, he calls everybody, but it's the ones who hearken. So be thoughtful about your partialities. Don't let them be according to man's judgment. Then in verse 6, this is tough. But you have despised the poor. You've despised the poor. It's real easy to despise the poor. And there's a lot of things they do that seemingly are worth despite. A lot of things they do, and you sit there and go, are you kidding me? You know, somebody will say, whatever. I don't want to get off on that. But people despise the poor. He didn't want us to do that. Because here's what he says. Do not rich men oppress you and draw you before the judgment seats? Do not they blaspheme that worthy name by the which you are called? They blaspheme the name of Jesus? If you fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love thy neighbor as yourself, you do well. But if you have respect to persons, you commit sin and are convinced of the law as transgressors. Wow. He's going, I mean, you guys, why do you have partiality? Somebody walks in who's famous and we're going to treat them special? You know how many times the church has done that and how many times it's been a complete disaster? Yeah. When, you know, to speak of the church in a broad sense, somebody gets saved who's got a name. They made a name in music. They made a name in acting. They made a name in politics. They made a name being rich. They made a name, some kind of name. And then we take them and we exalt them and because of what they've done in the world. And all it turns out to be, I mean, there are countless examples, is a disaster. They're exalted to the place oftentimes of trying to lead people. Are you kidding me? They don't know anything. They need to fall down on their face before God and be changed. And when they are, they're going to be lowly. And they're not going to be taking all of that we see in them as greatness in the world and using that in the church. Yeah. We're just really not interested in that. And that's what he's talking about. That we with partiality will take in the church and we will judge evil thoughts and we will begin to judge according to the things of this world and man's judgment in this world and the stature of people in the world. And we've seen it so many times. Oh, here's this great, wonderful, you know, celebrity who's now wants to serve the Lord. I'm just so thankful that, you know, that the Lord moves in mysterious ways and he's doing all these wonderful things and he just loves everybody and he accepts everybody for who they are. Everybody claps. Complete nonsense. Evil. Wrong. But we want to be accepted because we want to have our celebrity. We don't feel like we're close to the celebrity. It's a horrible thing. James is talking about this very pointedly and specifically, that we're not to do that. I want to go win that smart person. I want to go win that great man. I want to go win that beautiful woman, that whatever. I want to go win that person. No. No, he's chosen the lowly and the poor, rich in faith. That's who we're going after. The others can fall. They can humble themselves and come along too. Be great. Okay. So if you have respect to persons, verse 9, you commit sin. That's the point. You commit sin. You don't want to be a sinner. And are convinced of the law as a transgressor. Because remember, if you offend in one point, you're guilty of the whole law. If you offend this one point, you're guilty of the whole thing. For whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he's guilty of all. Yeah. For he that said, do not commit adultery, said also, do not kill. Now, if you don't commit adultery, but you kill, you're still a transgressor of the law. Go, well, I didn't do that one. I didn't murder, I didn't commit adultery, but my mouth is full of strife. You've got a problem. Verse 12, so speak ye and so do as they that shall be judged by the law of liberty. That's the word of God. Remember, he said earlier, be a doer of the word. keep the word. And here he's saying, keep the perfect law of liberty. He's reiterating it. That's what you want to go by. This is what you judge by. This is what you live by. This is what you want to be a hearer and a doer of, right?
Yeah.
For he shall have judgment without mercy that showed no mercy. In other words, you're going to be judged without mercy if you don't show mercy. And mercy rejoices against judgment. We have all these judgments. We've been taught judgments by our parents, by people we love and care about. We've been taught judgments often that are wrong. They thought they were right. They meant well, you could say, but they didn't know the word of God, and they didn't teach us to judge by the word of God. He says here, mercy. You want mercy from God? Show mercy.
Yeah.
You want to be forgiven? Forgive. Right? Same thing. Mercy rejoices against judgment. People use that all the time. They speak that all the time to say that, oh, God doesn't judge me. Right? Why are you judging me for my sin? They don't understand the context of what we've been talking about. Look at where we came from. We talked about enduring temptation. We talked about having no sin. We talked about being a doer of the word. Now he says mercy rejoices against judgment. You can't take that scripture out of the context of everything else that we've been talking about. Right? He's talking about partiality in yourselves. He's talking about how you view people. He's talking about how you despise the poor. He's not talking about how you commit all the sins you want and God still loves you just the same. It's not what he's talking about. He's talking about how you despise the poor. You need to have mercy so that God will have mercy upon you. How do you have mercy? You have mercy upon those unlovely ones. You have mercy upon the ones that the world would call despised. You have mercy on the ones that the world would reject. You need to have mercy on them. No partiality. You can have mercy on the rich man too, but you can't have mercy on the rich man and not the poor man. You need to have mercy on them all. That's what he's talking about. So when he talks about mercy rejoices against judgment, it's you looking, yeah, your judgment is, you're wise, you've got experience in the world. You see somebody and you go, that person is clueless, beyond clueless. They don't know how to do anything. They are never going to make anything of themselves good. And they're never going to accomplish anything in this life. They're dumb, they're slow, they're lazy, they're all these things. And you're in your judgment. So then you show them no mercy. I don't do that.
Yeah.
That's what this is talking about. So when you hear people talk about mercy rejoices against judgments, when you recognize that the mercy of God is such that even though you judge that person incapable of being saved, you judge them so far out there that they'll never get anything. Mercy. What does mercy do? Preaches the word.
Yeah.
Gives them another opportunity. Calls them. Says, come. Paul told us that if you give somebody second and third admonition and they refuse, call them anathema maranatha.
Yeah.
Cursed until the coming of the Lord. Just done. Right? Is that mercy? Give him two or three admonitions. Right? He said it. What's the point? Let me get back to what the word here is telling us. What's he talking about? He's talking about partiality in yourselves. Ask the Lord for wisdom. Lord, is there a place where I'm partial for and against people based upon my own judgments and not based upon the word of God? That's what he wants you to do. He doesn't want you to be a sinner. He wants you to be somebody who will give mercy to everyone, whosoever asks. What does it profit, my brethren, though a man says he has faith and has no works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, notwithstanding you give them not those things which are needful to the body, what does it profit them? What does it profit? What's it done? Even so, faith, if it does not have works, it's dead, being alone. Yea, a man may say, you have faith and I have works. I say to him, show me your faith without your works, and I'll show you my faith by my works. You believe there's one God. You do well. It's good. The devils also believe. They tremble at who he is. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect? And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. You see then how that by works a man is justified, and not by faith only. Likewise also, was not Rahab the harlot justified by works, when she had received the messengers, sent them out another way? For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. This tension that people often have, well, I'm saved by faith, I don't have to do any good works. Believe God, you'll be saved. It's that simple. But you had to believe him. When you believe, it's going to have an outworking in your life. And what he's talking about, being a doer of the word, that's part of the faith that we receive. You have to be a doer of the word. If I'm not a doer of the word, but a hearer only, I'm cursed. So if I say that I have faith, there will be an outworking. It's just like when Paul says, examine yourselves whether you be in the faith or not. There better be an outworking. There better be something that's happening in your life. There's a change that's occurring. But this comes after him telling us to be real careful about judging evil thoughts and judging according to things that we think we understand. Yeah. Word only. Word of God only. So what's one of the fruits that you've been saved? Joy. What's one of the fruits that you've been saved? Faith. One of the things you're going to have, you're going to begin to ask God in faith. And you're going to begin to have a relationship where you begin to talk to him. You're not talking, spending time talking to him? It's not an evidence that you've got, the faith is not working. You need to be asking. So when we see this long thing, it's very clear. Abraham believed God and it was counted him for righteousness. How did we know he believed God? Because when God said to do something, he did it. This is what happened. He was not a hearer of the word. He was a doer. Yeah. Go offer your son Isaac. Well, I would do it, Lord, but I'm just going to sit here and wait for you to tell me how great I am because I believe your word. And I would do it, but you know that I know it's not really what you want me to do. I mean, that wasn't going to work. He was obedient to the word, and he did it. There are countless examples I've heard of people that say, you know, they receive one word from God, just like Abraham. Go over here. So they walked over here. Now go back. It's like, what? Okay, go back. And you're wondering what's happening. What's going on? But then the next word is, now go through that door. And you go through the door. And now see that person, talk to them. Boom. And something happens. You don't always know the end of a thing, but obedience is key. Yeah. Abraham had confidence that God would raise him up. He said, I and the lad will go and worship and we will come back to you. He had confidence in that. But he was going to fulfill the word he received because that's the word he'd been given. Go do that. He went to do it. So faith without works is dead. That's been outworking. Consider, examine yourself whether you be in the faith or not. Okay. Now, temptation is coming and I keep succumbing to it and I keep failing every time temptation comes. Am I walking with God or not? Am I believing him or not? No, I'm not. So what do I do? Father, fill me with your joy. Fill me with your strength. Let me ask you in faith, Lord, I need wisdom for how to stop this. You know, so if I'm having a problem with something, if I'm having a problem with getting drunk, the wisdom might be, stop going to the bar. Oh, brilliant. You know, it might be as simple as stop drinking alcohol. Oh, that's how I get drunk. You know, you see what I'm saying? You ask God for wisdom, he's going to tell you what to do. Now when he tells you what to do, stop going to the bar. Stop going to the bar. Yeah. It's that simple. If it's some other problem and there's something that leads you down that path, stop doing it. God will give you wisdom. Stop. Just don't do it anymore. Okay. Chapter 3, verse 1. That's sort of the end of that section. So I'm going to go ahead and ask, is there anybody with a pressing question about what we've talked about? I mean, I know it's taken a while to get through two chapters, but this stuff's thick. Everybody's okay? Nothing that you're having trouble understanding? All right. Chapter 3, verse 1. My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. In other words, God said in his church, apostles, prophets, pastors, teachers, you know, evangelists, he said in his word, in his church, people to minister. That's what he's talking about. Don't be many of those. Don't everybody say, oh, I got to be, you know, everybody's a whatever, until God puts somebody in that place. But that does not preclude that we're not all supposed to be doing the work of an evangelist, that we're not all supposed to be doing the work of preaching the gospel, that we're not all supposed to be walking in faith, that we're not all supposed to be enduring temptation, that we're not all supposed to be praying for the sick, that they shall recover. I mean, we're all supposed to be doing those things. And I think it's important because sometimes people get mixed up. He says, don't be many masters. He says, okay, I'll just be a pew sitter. No, that's not what he's talking about.
Yeah.
He's just saying that there is a place where he will anoint certain people to do certain things. And in the church, the way it's supposed to function, he's not going to set people in those things until they've been tested and tried, that they're not going to take it and act like it's something to do with them.
Yeah.
It's not because they're smarter. It's not because they're, you know, better. It's not because of anything that they have done. It's because of God who gives the increase and God who says, I want to set them in this place. And it's not going to be according to man's judgment. And when he does that, you don't want to say, I'm going to be that, and then make it on your own, because that's what he's warning against. Oh, I think I'm going to go be an apostle, print myself some cards, apostle of the Lord Jesus, go out and start being an apostle. No, you're not. Oh, I went to school, I got my doctorate degree in apostleship, and I'm going to go be an apostle. No, you're not. Because that'll lead you down the path to hell right there. But what he says, don't be many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. There's going to be a greater temptation. There's going to be a greater struggle. There's going to be a greater thing. You get set up into a position. God sets you into position. He's prepared you because he won't allow you to be tempted above what you're able. He puts you in a position. There's going to be a greater condemnation you're going to have to deal with. For in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same as a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body. Wow. It's intense. Well, I'm going to come back to this. Let's read some more before we do. Behold, we put bits in the horses' mouths that they may obey us, and we can turn their whole body. Behold also the ship, big old ships, which though they be so great and are driven by fierce winds, yet are they turned about with a very small helm, wherever the master, the governor of the boat, wants it to go. That's what governor listeth means. Wherever he wants it to go, if he pushes it this way, turns that way, it's going to make it turn to the left. Right? He can direct the ship with that little rudder. It's pretty intense. Even so, the tongue is just a little member. And it boasts great things. Because people can talk and talk and talk about themselves so well. Boast great things. Behold, how great a matter just a little fire will kindle. If I just take a little fire, I can burn this whole building down if I do it right. And the tongue, it's a fire. It's a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell. Isn't that awful? Makes you want to pull your tongue out and clip the thing off. I mean, not that you really would, but you understand. It really does. You look at it thinking, wow, that tongue, it's a fire. It kindles, it's a little member, it'll kindle a conflagration and destroy people's lives so fast. You got to be careful with that tongue. It's set on fire of hell. Wow. For every kind of beasts and of birds and of serpents and things of the sea is tamed and has been tamed of mankind. But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil full of deadly poison. I mean, come on. That's awful. You think about it. If I said, I'm going to bring this thing into your house, I'm going to set it here on your counter, it's a bowl full of poison, and if you tip it onto anything that's wood, it'll completely burn everything that's there, and I'm going to set it here, all right? Is that okay with you? No. Please take that away. I don't want that in my house. Well, guess where it's attached? The temple of God. It's in the temple of God. That's pretty wild. Therewith, that with that little tongue, bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceeds blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. It just shouldn't be this way. This is wrong. Does a fountain send forth the same place, sweet and bitter, sweet water and bitter? Can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, or the vine figs? So can no fountain yield both salt water and fresh. Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. I'm going to come back to that. I'm going to go back up to the tongue for a moment. That tongue is an evil thing. Who can tame it? Who can tame it? No man can tame it. It's not tameable by men. And he started off this chapter with, be not many masters, for there's a greater condemnation. In many things we offend all. You have to know how the tongue is bridled, because there is one who can tame the tongue. It's the Holy Ghost. He will tame it. The Holy Ghost will put within you a watch. The psalmist and Peter quoted it, Lord, set a watch on my mouth. Keep the door of my lips. And may all my desire be to you. This is where we need to go. Father, help me. Strengthen me. My desire. Let my tongue speak sweet words, not bitter poison. Where does the bitter poison come from? I give into those judgments. I give into those partialities. I give into strife, talks about. And I allow my words to come forth and allow my tongue to act on its own. And what happens? Poison and fire. Not good fire. Bad fire. It's awful. This is what we have to do. So when he's talking about being a doer of the word, we got to bridle the tongue. It's like first on the list. Because he says, don't be many masters. Don't be walking around boasting of yourself. And he immediately gets into this. The tongue is a little member and boasts great things. Why would it boast great things? Because it talks about itself. It's a boasting. Because it talks about how I'm so much better than you. I'm stronger than you. I'm taller than you. I'm smarter than you. I'm whatever it might be. It boasts great things. Oh, I'm great. Oh, I can say, and I can with great flowery words convince men to follow me up the hill and into death itself. The tongue boasts great things, but it's really a fire and it's a poison. And we don't want to have that in our life. We want it to be tamed. So what he's going to talk about here is how we tame it. That's why I stopped. So verse 13, who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? So which one of, basically take it this way, which one of you can tame this little unruly thing? Okay? Let him show out of a good conversation, a good manner of living, his works with meekness of wisdom. Where do you get wisdom from? You ask of God, who upbraids not, right? All of this relates back to that first chapter. Verse 14, but if you have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. Where does the unruly tongue come from? Envy and strife. Envy and strife. That's really where it comes from. It's really hard to kill somebody with your tongue in terms of murder, I'm going to go kill you. I can kill you with my hands. I can kill you kicking you enough. It's hard to kill somebody with your tongue. But envy and strife, will destroy people just as much as killing them with the body. Envy and strife is awful, terrible stuff. And it's where a lot of this boasting comes from. Because where does boasting do? If I say to you, oh, I'm so blessed. I have all these great things. I've earned all this stuff because I've just done a better job than the rest of you over the last 10 years of laying up for myself treasures on earth, whatever it might be. And you begin to envy me? I've boasted great things, and you begin to envy. How about if it's something that's not so obviously ugly? What if I say, oh, the Lord has shown me such great and mighty things that I did not know? And then you begin to envy. Look, I didn't earn that. He gave that. Yeah. All you do is receive it, right? But what happens is that the tongue boasts great things. And if you have bitter envy and strife in your heart, don't glory. Don't lie against the truth. As soon as you notice any of that, this wisdom, that wisdom, the wisdom of bitter envy and strife, descends not from above, but it's earthly, it's sensual, it's devilish. You don't want that, ever. Don't let your tongue ever speak. If you sense in your heart any upset with somebody, any judgment against somebody, any frustration, any lack of mercy, any envy, any strife, cover it up. Just don't speak. You'd be better off. Don't say a word. For where envy and strife is, there's confusion and every evil work. Poison and a conflagration of awful fire. Where envy and strife is. So this is what the tongue does. What the tongue does is it lends itself to envy. It speaks of that which is ungodly. It speaks of that which is earthly. And it causes trouble in men's hearts. But the wisdom that is from above, that's the one we want, is first pure. Pure what? It's pure word of God. It's pure. There's no envy in it. There's no strife in it. There's no murder in it. There's no deceit in it. It's pure. The word, the wisdom from above is pure of all these things. Then it's peaceable. It's full of peace. Right? Gentle. And easy to be entreated, full of mercy. Remember, have mercy. You want to have mercy shown to you. And good fruits, joy, love, peace, without partiality, without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. Blessed are the peacemakers. How do you make peace? Let your tongue speak peace. What does he say? Peace to all men, them that are near, them that are far away. He says, peace. He says, come to everyone. This is what our tongue's supposed to be doing. Not envy and strife. Not division. Not argument. Not judgment of men's judgments. It's not what it's supposed to be doing. But see, it's the tongue that gets people into trouble. We get in trouble so quick because we begin to speak out of what we think or what we've learned or what we know or what we're frustrated about. We begin to talk, and what happens is that where there is many words, there wanteth not sin. Yeah. So we want to be careful. But listen to this wisdom that's from above. The last things it says, without partiality, there's that your judgments against people, how you have partiality amongst yourself and it's sin unto you, and without hypocrisy. No hypocrisy. What did Jesus say about hypocrites? Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. For you do not enter in, and you prevent them that would enter in from entering in. You make laws where you ritually purify all this stuff, but out of your mouth proceeds cursings. You know, it's whatever. He just gets on them about their hypocrisy because they're so judgmental against the lowly people who aren't like them, instead of showing mercy at need. That's just not what's happening. That's what the tongue does. So, blessed is the man who endures temptation. Be joyful. Shield faith. Stand with God. Ask him for wisdom. And what's the wisdom that you want? You want the wisdom that's pure and peaceable and gentle and easy being treated and full of mercy and good fruits, not partial, and without hypocrisy. That's what you want. And now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace. Of them who are peacemakers, them that make peace. Yeah. Peacemakers. Blessed are the peacemakers. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, that's the next section. So, where does strife and envy come from? From where come wars and fightings among you? Who's he talking to? Do you remember who he was talking to? The 12 tribes? Right? Why are they fighting amongst themselves? Why are the brethren fighting amongst themselves? What's going on here? What is one of the things that Israel did? The tribes fought amongst themselves constantly. They're like, you know, little kid siblings constantly taking the toy from one another. Just, it was a constant. It's not good. Why are there wars and fights among you? Do not they come hence even of your lust that war in your members? Remember how where temptation comes from? The lusts that are in your members? That's where temptation comes from. War and fighting is a fruit of evil. It's a fruit of succumbing to sin.
Yeah.
It's not a fruit of the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
Right? It's why, you know, you have so much trouble with politics. You know, the answer to all the problems of the world is go bomb them. It just, right on its face, you can sit there and go, that's just not right. It's just not right. It's not right. I can't be supportive of such a thing. I can't do that. It's just wrong.
Yeah.
Okay? And you begin to see that. Why are there wars and fightings among you? You lust and you do not have. You want something and you can't have it. You kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. You fight and war, yet you do not have. Why don't you have? Because you ask not. Well, wait a minute now. You're doing, I mean, you've just killed people. You've started wars. I mean, you're working pretty hard. What do you mean I didn't ask? You didn't ask the right person. Who did you ask? You asked your own strength. You asked your own way. You asked your own ability. And you consume it upon your lust, you asked of yourself to accomplish what you thought you could do. You didn't ask God. Remember, if any of you lack wisdom, don't get that earthly sensual wisdom that's so awful in the later chapter. Ask God, who gives to all men liberally and upbraids not. I mean, look what he gave us. We got the word of God. We have it more abundantly than any generation of people have ever had it. Because we can just type in envy on our computer and have scriptures on envy. It's just that quick. We got the word of God so amazingly given to us. All right. You ask not. You ask. Oh, you're getting better. And you don't receive. You receive not because you ask amiss, that you may consume it upon your lust. Remember when he said, where does temptation come from? Every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. And when lust has conceived, it brings forth sin. It says, you ask and receive not because you ask amiss that you may consume it upon your lust. I think that's a little conceiving. You've consumed it. Remember Eve? This is always very important. She took the apple or took the fruit. She looks at it and she says, wow, that's really good looking fruit. I mean, that's great. There are no worms in that. There's nothing bad about it. It looks really good and juicy. She did that. And she said, and you know, it's really cool because the serpent just told me this is going to make me wise. Notice wisdom, earthly, sensual, devilish. It's going to make me wise. And up to that point, she hadn't sinned. She didn't sin. She eats of it. Now she sinned. So what'll happen is there's this enticing thing telling you that you want, that you need, that you have to have this thing, whatever it may be. You have to have it, and it will come at you, and it will tell you you have to have it. And you might even see it and go, yeah, I want that. Lord, I want that. You might be asking, why do you want it? So I can eat it, so I can be wise, so I can have the things of this world, so I can have whatever it is in this world that I think I want. And it's temptation. And this whole book is about how to resist that. So what do I need to do? I need the wisdom of God. Well, the wisdom of God was given. The word was given. Don't eat of it. Pretty simple. God gave his judgment. Don't eat of it. All she had to do was not eat of it. Say, well, God told me not to eat of it. Walk away. She could have done that at any stage along the way, but she didn't. She just kept going. She kept listening. She kept getting closer. Finally takes it. And she says, we're not supposed to eat of it, neither even touch it. Where did that come from? Because God never said don't touch it. But see, don't touch it would have been wise, because why get so close that you could eat it? Just don't touch it, right? That's what we tell our kids all the time. Just stay away from that. Well, touching it, she goes, well, nothing happened. Must be okay. It's all right. I can watch that stuff, and it didn't affect me. Maybe you didn't think it affected you that time. It's coming. And then you eat it. This is what the stages are. So what you have to do is when you ask God for wisdom, he's going to start showing you. I don't want you to eat of that. Don't go to the bar. Okay, I won't go anymore. And you learn how to do this. You ask and receive not, because you ask to consume it upon your lust. So your asking is wrong. You adulterers and adulteresses. Wow. Know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. We don't want to be a friend of the world. You see cars all the time now with these NOTW stickers, you know, not of this world. And you wonder, I hope you're not of this world. Lord, I don't want to be of this world. Father, I think you've made me not of this world. Lord, I thank you that even as you were not of this world, I'm not of this world, because that's what you made me. And you begin to give thanks. Do you think the scripture says in vain, the spirit that dwells in us lusts to envy? Do you think it's telling you something? But he gives more grace. Wherefore, he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. So here's another weapon that you have. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. He'll lift you up. Humility is huge. Don't exalt yourself. Because remember, we were talking about why are there wars and fightings. You know why? Because people exalt themselves in their pride. I exalt myself in your pride, in my pride. You exalt yourself in your pride. And pretty soon the two prides, somebody's got to win. We got to beat each other until somebody wins. Because somebody's pride's got to be shown to be the best. That's what happens. You know how many wars in the European era were because they were all related? And my country's better than your country, and I'm going to prove it. My army's bigger than yours. I got more ships than you got. And that's what they did until World War I happened. They just kept, they were all family members. They're all related to one another through marriage or through blood or something. And they're all exalting their own particular nation and making alliances with other parts of nations until finally one little spark in Serbia. And boom, we're in World War I. And you know, multiplied tens and hundreds of thousands of people die. And did they stop? No, they kept fighting each other until they got to World War II, and then it was even worse, right? That's why are there wars and fights? It's a good example for why are there wars and fighting? Because of bitter and envy in your heart and pride and arrogancy in your heart. No, he says, humble yourself. Submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. We're talking about European wars, but really the war that's most important is the one that you're having to deal with your own lust and enticed. Where you're being enticed by something that really looks good to you. And you think you want that, and you think you need that, and you think that it's something worth having. And you're enticed. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. God resists the devil. He's going to flee. And God's going to give you wisdom and show you how ugly that thing really is. And okay, I don't want that anymore. I don't want that in my life. Draw nigh to God. He'll draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Wow. Be afflicted. Mourn. Weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning, your joy to heaviness. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord. He'll lift you up. That's called repentance. That's what that is. You find yourself even in temptation, you should be submitting yourself to God. How much more if it's conceived and it brings forth death? Be afflicted, mourn, weep, do whatever you got to do. Fast, pray, cry out to God for wisdom, whatever it might be. Be serious and intentional about it. Go after it. It's so easy to get kind of lazy about it because God is so loving and so forgiving. But when you're seeing the evil thing, when you're seeing it happen, when you're seeing the lust begin to manifest and the temptation is there, recognize God's not tempting you. The devil's tempting you. God has given you the weapons to defend against it. That's what you want to remember. Then I can rejoice. Oh, Lord, it's a temptation. You've given me the ability to stand against this. Instead of, man, it looks good. Nobody will know. I'll just take it. It'll be okay. That's the wrong way to go. And what prevents you from seeing what it is? Envy and strife and the tongue. The things that men speak. This is why you don't want to be a friend of the world. Because when you go out into the world, their words continually will be tearing down the word of God. They just continually will be speaking against it. It almost like muffling it. Stopping up your ears so you can't hear God because it's filling you with lies. Just saying things. Even things that seem to us to be innocent. They're not bad. No, they're not hurting anybody. But they're contrary to the word of God, even in a small seeming way. And what they do is they prevent us from hearing God. And they exalt us into being, oh, I'm wise. Oh, I'm thoughtful. Oh, it's okay. It's all right. I'm going to be part of the crowd. I'm going to do what everybody else does. It's all right. That way I can win them. You know, whatever it might be. We have all these justifications that will lead us down that road. This is what he's talking about. No, when you see any evil, this is what you do. Draw nigh to God. Cleanse your hands if they need to be cleansed. Purify your heart. God will give you a pure heart. Don't be double-minded. Ask God in faith. Believe him. He'll give you wisdom. He'll strengthen you. He'll teach you how to avoid sin. As it says in Proverbs, when you see it, you avoid it. You pass not by it. You just let it go. You stay away from it. Yeah. It's like taking all that superfluity of naughtiness and pushing it away. I'm not going to have anything to do with that. I'm going to go someplace else. Yeah. So, repentance, be afflicted, mourn, weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning, your joy to heaviness. You are in heaviness, if need be, through many full temptations. Is it the same thing? It's a little bit different. Because we know that joy, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. But if it has conceived and it brings forth sin, now you need to weep. Yeah. Now you need to cry out to God. Godly sorrow works repentance. Repentance, not to be ashamed of. Repentance will bring you to what? Purity. Yeah. Cleansing. Stand you up. Strengthen you so that you can go forward again. All right. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord. He will lift you up. Speak not evil one of another, brethren. We're back to the tongue. He that speaks evil of his brother and judges his brother speaks evil of the law and judges the law. Well, you shouldn't judge me. You shouldn't tell me that I shouldn't do those things. That's not what it's talking about. We think, as Paul said, we have better thoughts of you, my beloved brethren. We expect every one of you. You'll hear Pastor Mark say it a lot of times where he says, I see every one of you in the purposes and plan of God. Yeah. Now, the purpose and the plan of God may be that you're in heaviness through manifold temptations, if need be, until you come out pure and tried. But it's the plan of God. What you see is you see it after the Spirit, right? So what he says here is don't speak evil and don't judge your brother. Don't get involved in your mind trying to figure things out. Don't speak evil of the law and judge the law. If you judge the law, you're not a doer of the law. You're a judge of the law. Just do it. You do it. Yeah. Don't go around telling other people they have to do it. Don't be mini masters. Just do it. There is one lawgiver who is able to save and to destroy. Who art thou that judges another? Go to now. It's an interesting phrase. It's an idiom. Go to now. What does that mean? Go to now? Where am I going to now? What he's saying is, basically, he's saying, now get up and do this. Okay? You that say, today or tomorrow we will say unto such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get gain. Whereas you do not know what shall be on the morrow. For what is your life? It's even a vapor that appears for a little time, vanishes away. This is what you ought to say. If the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that. In other words, everything you do, you submit it unto God. And your very tongue speaks. Because what's he talking about? How do you speak? What is it that you say with your mouth? Because he told us, you can kindle a great fire with just a little word. And so he's telling you, even down to your very speech, don't say, oh, I'm going to go do this thing. Oh, I'm going to go get an A on that test. No, if the Lord will, I'm going to go do that. It's just a difference of attitude. It's a difference of speaking, because it's very important that you humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, because everything you do that's good came from him. He's the one who gave. He said earlier, oh, I gave all the righteous gifts, all the good gifts, everything comes down from the Father of light. It all comes down from him. Your very life is his. You have nothing, but he didn't give it to you. Right? And so it's very important that we humble ourselves in that way, and that we recognize, I'm here, I'm a servant of the Most High God. There's nothing that I want for myself, because that's where things will begin to lead me down the path of being deceived. Lord, I'm your servant. It's hard for us to understand what it's like to be a slave. If you are a slave in any era, in any place, there's been slavery all over the world of all different kinds. If you were a slave, you didn't get to decide where you were going to go, where you were going to live, how you were going to do it. You were told what you did. You're the guy, you're the slave whose job it is to dig the latrine pits. Okay? This is what you do. You take the shovel, you dig the pit. Every time we move the tent, go over there, your job's to dig that one. And your job's to cover the old one up, dig the new one. That's your job. It's what you do. You don't get to say, you know, can I have another job? I'd like to do something different. I think I have a great idea. I'm going to go over here. No, you don't get to do those things. When you recognize that you're a servant of the Most High God, now you begin to walk in humility before him. Say, Father, what do you want me to do? Where do you want me to go? And now you say, Lord, it seems good. I'm going to go over here and get gain and work in this place. You're asking him, Lord, that's what I think I ought to do. If you will, that's what I'll do. And this is how we do this. All right. So even down to your tongue. Now, verse 16, you rejoice in your boastings. All such rejoicing is evil. Wow. That's like, no, he's not giving it any half measure. Not all such boasting kind of leads towards evil. No, all such boasting is evil. Therefore, to him that knows to do good and does it not, to him it's a sin. That's pretty intense. It's a sin? Yeah. You know to do good and you don't do it? It's sin. So then he says, you rich men, go to now, you rich men, weep and howl for your miseries that shall come upon you. Your riches are corrupted. Your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver is cankered, and the rust of them shall be a witness against you and shall eat your flesh as it were fire. You have heaped treasure together for the last days. A lot of people doing that. Behold, the hire of the laborers who have reaped down your fields, which is of you kept back by fraud, cries, and the cries of them which have reaped are entered into the ears of the Lord of Sabbath. He understands what's going on. You have taken advantage of people. You have used them for your own ends, that you might gain what you wanted for yourself. And the judgment is pretty intense. He's on them. You have lived in pleasure on the earth and been wanton. You have nourished your hearts as in a day of slaughter. In other words, you know, you're going to kill a whole bunch, and so you eat more that day than you ever. It's like harvest time. You eat more than you ever ate before. He says, you've lived as if it was the day of the greatest feast every single day. You live as if everything exists for you so that you can have more, so that you can satisfy your flesh on the earth. You have condemned and killed the just, and he does not resist you. Ooh, isn't that interesting? The just doesn't resist. That's pretty intense. Be patient, therefore, brethren. Let me stop there for a minute. He's got back on the rich man. This is not to sit here and start trying to draw the line. If you have more money than this, you're rich. If you have a nice, if you have extra this, you're rich. That, look, the definition of rich is all over the place. There are rich people in other countries that would come here and be poor. There are poor people here might go there and be rich. So as far as countries go and where we live, we're more likely to fit into the rich man category than the poor man category, no matter who you are. So let's be a little bit careful how we do it. But what he's talking about is the attitude of heart. You consume it, you ask to consume it upon your own lust. Lord, I need more food. Lord, I need more money. Lord, I need more safety for myself. I need more comforts. I've got to have these things, and you know I need them, Lord. So I need these things. You ask, and you don't have the wisdom of God. Because remember, when we're talking about asking here, in the context of this book, he's talking about asking God for wisdom. Yeah. That's really what he's talking about. And wisdom to avoid temptation, and wisdom to endure temptation, and wisdom to come through it, try it as gold, that your patience will have its perfect work, and your faith will be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. That's your goal. That's what we're after. So all this stuff is all talking about what gets in the way. You have not because you ask not. And when you ask to consume it upon your own lust. And this is what happens when you do that. This is the fulfillment of it, to where your entire life is, where can I get my next paycheck? Where can I get my next bowl of food? Where can I get my next nicer house? Where can I get my next, whatever it may be? And that's all you're after, and it consumes your thoughts, and it consumes your being, and it's everything that you desire. Now we all sit and go, well, that isn't me. Oh, thank God it ain't you. We're very happy it isn't you. But you know how you start down that road? It's just a little thing. I got to have that little thing. I got to have this thing. Well, it's just a little thing. I just need a little bit more of this. Just a little bit, and everything will be easier. And God's telling us, no. This is the wisdom that descends from earthly, devilish things. The wisdom of how to do all this stuff. The wisdom that's from above is pure and it's peaceable and it's gentle. And the just, they don't resist the proud. God resists the proud every day. He does, right? He resists them. What does he resist them in? Because many of them are out there, they got great things. They're so proud, they got enclaves and money that they don't even know what to do with. Right? They don't look very resisted. What are they resisted? Faith. See, what's more precious than gold? Faith. And that your faith would be tried and found perfect and entire, wanting nothing. That's the goal. None of this makes any sense if your goal isn't that my faith would be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. I want it to be tried as gold. Therefore, I count it all joy when I enter into diverse temptations. And I go to God and I ask in faith, believing him that he's going to give me the wisdom to stand against it. And if I've failed 10 times, 100 times, and I see that my failure, I'm going to say, Lord, am I asking upon my own lust? What am I doing? Lord, come give me wisdom. But I'm asking you in faith, knowing you're going to give me wisdom and that this thing is going to be defeated in my life, because I will not allow it to be any other way, because you said it has to be this way. Yeah. That's the attitude that we want to have. We're not going to be worrying about the fact I failed 100 times. Now, that's a terrible thing, and your heart can get pretty hard doing that. Right. Yeah. Because what will happen along the way is you start to feel like, well, then this just must be normal. That's the fear. Don't ever accept sin as normal. Ever. Not one time is it normal. But neither am I going to sit around judging somebody who keeps falling, because when they get up, they're crying out to God, Lord, I don't ever want to fall again. I should be having great mercy upon that person. And it's hence mercy. Show mercy, because God shows mercy to you. Yeah. Right? These are the people. I want my faith to be tried. So then he's talking about these rich men. He's going, everybody gets caught up. And which rich man is talking about? No, he's talking about you. Don't act like this, even in a small way. Ask God for his wisdom, that which comes from above. Don't be of this world. Lord, we're not of this world. Lord, I want to be of you, of heaven. Right? All right. Let me keep reading. because there's so many of these things that get answered as you go. Verse 7, be patient therefore. Therefore, be patient. Let patience have a perfect work, that your faith may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing, right? Be patient therefore unto the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman waits for the precious fruit of the earth and has long patience for it until he receive the early and latter rain. Be ye also patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord draws nigh. He's coming for you, whether by, as we say, catching away or rapture, or by the grave. He's coming for you. The coming of the Lord's drawing nigh. It's nearer today than it was. Whatever the end of my life is, it's nearer today than it was yesterday. Yeah. The coming of the Lord draws nigh. He's coming for me. So regardless, people will say, well, he's delayed his coming. He's not delayed his coming. The raptures can come any day. We would know there's the things that have to be fulfilled for. We can sit here and we can talk about all that stuff. But the reality is his coming for you is any day. Yeah. It's coming. So it draws nigh. Grudge not one against another, brethren. The grudge is envy. Okay? Don't get into grudging against one another. Well, how come she's so blessed and I'm so poor? You know, whatever. Lest you be condemned. Behold, the judge stands before the door. In other words, the coming of the Lord draws nigh. Your judge is coming. Take, my brethren, the prophets who've spoken in the name of the Lord for an example of suffering affliction and of patience. Behold, we count them happy which endure. Oh, the end of Job was so wonderful. He got twice as many cattle and twice as much on this earth. And he had a whole bunch of beautiful daughters and kids, and everything was wonderful for him. Oh yeah, but remember the example of what he went through to get there. We count them happy which endure. You've heard of the patience of Job. Seen the end of the Lord. The Lord's very pitiful and of tender mercy. But above all things, my brethren, swear not, neither by heaven, neither by earth. Let me tell you what this means. This means I'm going to do it in my strength. By heaven is my witness, I'm going to accomplish that. That's what this is talking about. Okay? That's it. We don't want to do that. As soon as you stand up and rise up in your strength, you will fall. Yeah. Let every man take heed, thinking he stands, lest he fall. Because I don't stand. I can't stand. I can't do anything. Jesus said, of myself, I can do nothing. But as I hear that I speak, as I hear that I judge, yeah, as I see that I do. Right? Above all things, my brethren, swear not, neither by heaven, neither by earth, neither by any other oath. Don't you do that. Don't you ever go say that you're going to pledge yourself to accomplish something. I promise you, brother, I'll be there for you. Sounds great. You might even mean well. But don't swear like that. Let your yea be yea, your nay be nay. You ask me, will you be there tomorrow to help me? Yes, sir, I'll be there. That's it. If the Lord will, I'll be there. Yeah. That's the attitude. Let your yea be yea, your nay be nay, lest you fall into condemnation. Wow. Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. Remember, I was telling you that the answer for temptation was joy and faith. Now he's going to give us the short version for a bunch of these things, because he just doesn't want to go on for another 20 chapters. Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. Any sick? Let him call for the elders of the church. Let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. I mean, this is the answer. It doesn't matter what your problem is. You afflicted? What does he tell you to do? Pray. Pray. You go, man, I'm so afflicted. Good, pray. Pray. Are you happy? Don't go running around saying, I'm so happy, everything's good for me, 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 me. Begin to sing psalms. What are the psalms full of? Praise the Lord. The Lord is great. He sits in heaven and he over all things, and he's wonderful and he's mighty and he's loving and forgiving and thank, you know, this is what you do. So we find these things is what we're going to do. Verse 16, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that you may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. You know, we're always talking about how we're going to move mountains with this prayer. What's he talking about? He's talking about seeing people restored. Because it says you got a fault. I failed. I was envious of you. I spoke evil against you. I killed your cat, whatever it might be. I did something against you. And so I come to you and I confess my faults. And the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man will avail much forgiveness. That's the prayer we're talking about. I mean, this is a greater miracle than casting mountains in the sea, see people restored out of condemnation. It's an amazing thing. Effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Elias was a man subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. I mean, that's pretty intense. You know, you could say, I prayed it didn't rain. It didn't rain for a day. That's a mighty miracle. He prayed and didn't rain. It was 3.5 years. You know, you could call it didn't rain one day a coincidence. 3.5 years? Ain't no coincidence. He prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. Brethren, and so this is what I was talking to you about. If any of you do err from the truth and one convert him, let him know that he which converts the sinner from the error of his way shall save a soul from death and shall hide a multitude of sins. It's the greatest miracle. So we begin this book talking about temptation. Brethren, count it all joy when you enter diverse temptations, because that's the first weapon that's going to get you through it. Because you're going to be thankful and joyful that God has given you a way out. And if any of you convert somebody else, if anybody you help somebody else through their temptations, having mercy upon them, you can save a soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. Isn't that great? I mean, that's power. You want power on earth? The power to convert a sinner from death unto life is the greatest power you have. Jesus said, which is easier? To say to the sick of the palsy, rise, take up your bed and walk, or to say your sins be forgiven you. But so that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, he said to the man sick of the palsy, rise, take up your bed and walk. Because he counted it a greater power to forgive them of their sins. But people couldn't see that. So by healing the sick and raising them up, it testified that the one who forgives sins is here. And they were forgiven. And so all throughout the book, you saw forgiving sins, restoring such a one. I mean, these are the things that go on in this power. So we now know all the secrets of wisdom of how to walk before God righteously. And we have no excuse any longer. Are you tempted? Is there a temptation? Immediately, these words will come to your mind. Rejoice. Be thankful. Ask in faith for wisdom. Father, I know you've made a way of escape, and you give to all men liberally, and you do not upbraid me for asking you. Lord, I'm struggling here. This thing looks really good, and I'm recognizing that's not maybe where I need to go. Father, help me. These are just examples to kind of get you to take it to your own life. Because a lot of times we read this stuff and say, okay, well, you know, it sounds interesting. But you want to bring it right down to what is he talking about? This entire book, he's talking about what you're supposed to do, how you're supposed to walk. Be really careful what you say. Be really careful what you do. Lay it before the Lord. Ask him for wisdom. He'll give it to you. Love one another. So, Father, we thank you for the power on earth to forgive sins. Lord, we thank you that you have given us that power, that we can go to people and say, your sins are forgiven you. All they have to do is repent. All they have to do is turn to the light. And we have abundance of mercy given unto us that we might be able to show abundance of mercy to everyone that we meet, calling them out of their darkness and into his marvelous light. Just as our Father, just as he is so merciful and so forgiving, and yet will in no wise clear the guilty, He will come and make the guilty right. All they have to do is call upon his name. And his blood, the blood of Jesus, washes away all sin. Amen. Amen. Book of James. It's one of my favorites. So, does anybody have any questions? First of all, about the book of James. Anything that we read? I mean, we skipped some things a little faster, and I spent way too much time on some of them. Hold on. You have to have the microphone so they can record it.
I was just wanting to ask if you could maybe go over it again and maybe use more of examples of how we can speak to people when they're talking about being not judged again. Like you went over it and you were hitting it very good for me, but in the same sense, can we go over it just one more time and give more examples of how, you know, because I hear that from people, or like, how do we really help explain that to them again? And you were doing a good job of that, but I just was hoping you could go over again and give more examples.
Well, praise the Lord. Holy Ghost, you're so good. So let's go to Matthew. We'll just go to the scripture on these subjects. Is the best way to answer any question is, what is the scripture? So Matthew chapter 5. I just have to find the right verse. 7:1. Sorry, I knew I'd find it. It would have taken me a while. Let's back up a little bit. Go to verse 28 of chapter 6. Why take you thought for raiment? Now remember in James, we were reading where he talked about you ask to consume it upon your own lust. And Jesus has been talking a lot here about, don't seek after these things. Right? Don't seek after these things. God knows you need them. Don't seek after them, right? And we'll talk more about that as we go. But he says this, why do you take thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon, all his glory, was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast in the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we clothe? For after all these things the Gentiles seek. You're never good to be likened to what the Gentiles do. For your heavenly Father knows that you have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for tomorrow, for tomorrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. What does that mean? And we're going to get to the next verse in a minute, but I want you to relate this to James. Okay? A couple of things. When we talk about take no thought for tomorrow, we were talking about how I'm going to go do this, right? We get way too, it's good to have a plan. It's good to have a goal. What's our first goal from James? That our faith would be perfect and entire, wanting nothing, right? That's my goal. What is it that you want? I want my faith to be perfect, entire, wanting nothing. So I need patience and wisdom to endure temptation and not succumb to it, okay? That's my goal. And now I have a way to get through my goal, right? So he's saying, seek the kingdom of God first. You ask to consume it upon your own lust is the opposite of seek the kingdom of God first. So I'm seeing how this relates. Then he says, take no thought for tomorrow. Sufficient of the day is the evil thereof. Well, what is the evil thereof? It's the temptation of today. Not the temptation of tomorrow, it's the temptation of today. What am I tempted to do today that God does not want me to do? What am I tempted to be consumed with today? How am I walking today? I'm looking in the Word of God saying, this is who I am today, so I need to walk as who I am today. And if there is an enticement, and I recognize that, I begin to rejoice today. We often put it off till tomorrow. Okay? And this relates, Brad, we're going to get there. We often put it off till tomorrow. Thinking about how we got it all figured out for today. I got a plan. I have enough gas in my car today. I have enough food in the refrigerator. I have a roof that doesn't leak. I'm doing good today. We think that we're all sufficient for today. No, there's an evil today to be resisted. There's an evil to be cast down. Well, what evil is it? Is it always about you? No. What God wants it to be is to where it's about you, meaning somebody else, to get rid of the evil there. Right? So then he says, judge not, that you be not judged. What is he talking about? Why does that relate to this? What are my judgments about? Judge not, you be not judged, for with what judgment you judge, you shall be judged. And with that, what measure you meet, it shall be measured to you again. And why do you behold the mote in your brother's eye and consider not the beam that's in your own eye? Or how will you say to thy brother, let me pull the mote out of thine eye, and behold, there's a beam in your eye. You are a hypocrite. First cast the beam out of your own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye. So when we talk about judge not, it's in the context, in James, in the same context, to talking about resisting temptation, seeking the kingdom, the wisdom that's from above, not the wisdom that's from the earth. It's in that context. And when he says judge not, he's really talking about the way we judge people by earthly judgments when he says unto us, when you have partiality in yourselves, you sin. That's the judgment that's being talked about here and the judgment that's being talked about in James. To where we, in our partiality, judge people by the way they wear their hair, by the way they dress, by the way that they appear unto us, by the way they talk, by the fact that they have an accent or they don't, by the fact that we have judgments against groups and we identify them with a group and then we say that that group is bad. Oh, they're a gangbanger. Oh, they're an evil person. Oh, they've given themselves over to pride and arrogancy. And we begin to judge them by our own natural abilities instead of by the Word of God. And we don't show mercy where we're supposed to show mercy. Because what are we supposed to be doing with them no matter where we meet them? Are we concerned about, I'm going to go trade with you and you're going to take advantage of me because you're a slimy bad guy who's going to do, he's going to steal from me and therefore I got to defend against you stealing from me? No. I'm going to minister to you the Word of God. I'm going to tell you, we had to buy a car. So we're talking to the guy, and I said to him, I cannot complete a deal without making sure that you understand that who we are. We're here to tell you about Jesus and that you must be born again, and that you must receive the life of God to go on and to live forever. Deal can't be consummated until that's been spoken. Oh, you're going to be upset with me now because I'm Jewish. Good! That's wonderful, man. Jesus was Jewish. And you begin to talk. I mean, everything we do, is it doesn't matter who they are. It doesn't matter our judgment of how they're taking advantage of us or not, or how we like them or don't like them, or we like the way they act. Those are the judgments that are being talked about. Not the judgment of all adulterers shall have their part in the lake of fire. All murderers shall have their part in the lake of fire. All envy and all strife shall be destroyed. All adultery, all fornication, all lasciviousness, all everything that is unlike God shall be destroyed. That judgment was already spoken by God long before we ever existed. He's lived in that judgment for all eternity, knowing the things that will destroy. That judgment is not what's being talked about. It says, judge not. If I find you in sin, let him, brother, know. If you convert a brother, you convert one from the error of his ways, you save a soul from death. So I think your question was, how do we deal with this concept? Because they're taking the judgment, it's the wrong thing. The judgment that you're not supposed to do is the partiality against people by the earthly judgments that we make. That's the judgment. The judgment of homosexuality is condemned by God. I can say that all day long. It's not I that made that judgment. God made that judgment. I'm agreeing with him, and thankfully so. Very happy to agree with him. But the same God that said that, said that envy and bitter envy and bitterness in your heart will condemn you as well. So I'm going to say to you, don't have bitter envy either. You need to let it go. You need to forgive. You need to show mercy as God showed you mercy. James is dealing a lot with those kind of things in what we read. So does that help, Brad, answer the question in a different place? It's amazing when you take the Word of God and you begin to read contexts around scriptures and you find out that you can preach the book of James from Matthew 6 and 7. Isn't that amazing? It just happened by accident. No, it did not. I mean, it's just complete nonsense how people walk around talking about how, like, the Word of God is written by a bunch of men. Yeah, that's pretty amazing. The Jewish just James wrote a book, said the exact same thing Paul said, exact same thing Jesus said. The Holy Ghost moved upon men, and they spake as they were moved on by the Holy Ghost. So judge not that you be not judged. Have no partiality amongst yourselves. That's really what it is, because James led it very clearly. You have partiality in yourself, you're a sinner. It's like, wow, Lord, I don't want to judge any man after the flesh. It was said to us very clearly, judge no man after the flesh. Just don't do it. Judge righteous judgment. Did Jesus speak righteous judgment? Yes, he did. When they came to him with the woman in adultery, they said she needed to be condemned. Law said she needed to be condemned. So he just wrote in the ground. And they're like, you've got to do so. They're trying to tempt him. And he looks up and just says, let he that is without sin among you cast the first stone. And he goes back to writing on the ground. And the wiser ones, the older ones, drop their stones first. Because they said, all right, I get it. What's he illustrating? Show mercy. Show mercy. Does that sin that she had need to be washed away?
Yeah.
Does she know it needs to be washed away? Oh, yeah. If she didn't know before, she certainly knows now. She's publicly humiliated and she is up for judgment. And then Jesus looks at her and goes, neither do I condemn thee. Go. Sin no more. He judged that sin. And she had already judged it. And she knew it was wrong probably before she did it. James is talking to us, how do you live free from it? Okay, I thank God for his mercy that when I have done something really stupid, when I have not done these things, and if I have failed, that his mercy is there to immediately restore. Therefore, since he's shown such great mercy to me, I am not going to sit around judging you for the failures that I think I see in your life. Notice, I think I see. Because much of our judgment of men, it's colored by things that make it hard to see. It's like looking, and you can't really quite make it out, but you think you saw, or you think you understood. But if you see somebody commit a sin, go to them. Tell them, I saw what you did. You need to repent. And if they will refuse to hear you, because you love them, you go get the elders of the church and say, I saw him do this, and he refused to repent. And then they'll deal with it. And people say, well, don't be a tattletale. He needed you to tell. Right? Yeah. But I don't like the way you wore your hair. I don't like the way you dress. I don't like the have no partiality. Amongst yourselves, show mercy equally. Love the one that you know better as much as the one you know don't know as much. Love the one that looks rich and powerful as much the same as you love the one who's poor and miserable looking. You love them all the same. You have show mercy to them all the same. We just don't judge according to those things. You know, people talk about racism and classism and all these things. Look, in the kingdom of God, there is none of that. There's no male, there's no female, there's no rich, there's no poor, there's no Scythian, there's no bond, there's no free, there's no... I mean, it's like everybody's equal. Come on in. Everybody's the same. I don't look around going, we're going to divide among you. You're in the good pile, you're the bad pile, you're in the acceptable pile, you're in the I don't know about you pile. I mean, it's just... that's not what we do. We show no partiality. James spent a lot of time on that. That's why I spent a lot of time on it, trying to help people understand. This is a big deal. And Jesus put it in his sermon. Judge not. Be not judged. Be quick to hear. Slow to speak. Slow to wrath. Yeah. If you're uncertain, what should you do? Pray. Ask for wisdom. Pray. Cry out to God. Lord, bless my brother. Bless my sister. Keep them from the evil. He told us to pray for ourselves. I pray for other people too. Lord, keep them from the evil. You know? And just like we don't want to be discouraged, we want to be constantly moving forward. We're not worried about tomorrow, not dwelling on yesterday. Today, sufficient unto day, is the temptation, the evil thereof. Did that help with the judge part? So, simple example for people, and then you're next. Take the microphone from Brad. Take the microphone from Brad.
Can you better flesh out the mote and the beam aspect of the judgment part?
If you have partiality in yourself, to where you judge people by their appearance or you judge people by earthly things, how can you righteously deal with them? You must cast that sin out of your own life before you can deal with them. Okay. A lot of people think it means, well, he's committing adultery and I've got a little bit of envy. So I'm going to cast a little bit of envy out so that I can deal with his big thing of adultery. No. That your little bit of envy is just as bad as his big adultery. That's not what it's talking about. It's talking about something that in yourself makes your judgment suspect. And so in this context, what makes your judgment suspect? It's your partiality. It's your earthly judgments. It's the things that you think you know about people that help you to understand what you should do. It's the way you're trained to deal with people in the world. If you're in medical things or psychological things or whatever, you're trained to judge people by earthly things. And that partiality that you have can get in the way of the judgment of God. That's really what it's talking about. So what does he want us to do? He wants us to be like Abraham. You obeyed. You believed God and you did what he said. Be a doer of the word, not a hearer only. Jesus talked about it in the sermon that we were just reading. He talked about what you're supposed to do. Plant your feet upon the rock, not upon the sand. You're supposed to do the word of God. I only do what the word of God says. I mean, this is all the messages that he said. This is what you want to do. This is how you want to live your life. What am I doing today? Well, what I'm believing I'm doing today, what I'm praying for God, Lord, if it be your will, I'm doing the things you told me to do today. All right, I got a whole list of things to do today that I believe God told me to do today. So I'm going to do those things today. And I'm going to say, Father, make me better able to hear and make me better able to obey so that I can be perfectly in the faith, but be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. So that when you have faith, what can you do? You can say unto this tree, be thou removed and planted in the sea. When you have faith, you can say to the sick of the palsy, rise, take up your bed and walk. Right? I want it to be perfect, entire, wanting nothing. What keeps it from being that? Because I succumb to temptations. What do I succumb to? Succumb to the evil of the day that comes against me and tries to deceive me and causes me to deviate from the path that God has given me. And so I'm not doing what he told me to do. And then I become a judge of, well, I'm not doing what this one's doing. I must not be as good. I must be bad. No, I need to be doing what God told me to do. Now, the hardest part for me, people, is God will tell you what to do and you be a forgetful hearer. You look in the glass, oh yeah, that's right. And then you walk away and you forget what you're supposed to be about. You forget what you're supposed to be doing. The Lord may have spoken to you in a dream. He may have spoken to you in a vision. He may have spoken to you from his word. The pastor may have told you. And you're not doing what you were supposed to do. Come on, you need to do it. And sometimes those things build up because we refuse over and over. And that's, pastor deals with that a lot, where he's trying to tell us, listen, yeah, you've had a lot of failures now. Here's the mercy of God. Now get it right. Obey this. Okay. And then do the next thing. So the mote is really your earthly judgments, your partialities, your way of viewing people. I think I know what her problem is. Her problem is that she's got this in her life. And you judge that according to the way you see people. Yeah. Just like the Pharisees told the disciples, oh, he's lunar struck. That's what he's got. It's the phase of the moon that causes this. And so, and a lot of people believe that kind of stuff for many, 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 many centuries. So it, at that time, it wouldn't have sounded so crazy. And it sounded like a reasonable thing. And they're going, yeah, I guess that's what it is, the full moon. This would be easier to cast out if it wasn't such a full moon. I don't know what they were thinking. But it was blinding their judgment, right? So that's, I believe, what he's talking about. He talks about the lights. Our earthly judgments, our partialities, our way of viewing things that get in the way of the word of God that says, get the adultery out of your life, man. Repent. Get it right. That's, you can preach that. You're not judging anybody by that standard. You're telling them to be free, but you would tell the rich man the same thing. It's like we'll go to a poor man, tell him, man, you shouldn't be living with that woman who's not your wife. The guy's got no money. Guy doesn't know what else to do. He's never been taught right. He's living with his girlfriend because he doesn't even, never even thought about it. And we're judging him for it. And then we go to this rich man who's had five wives and whatever, and we're telling him it's okay. That's partiality. Yeah. It's the same word of God to deliver both of them from the error of their ways needs to be there. And if I treat him different than him, then I have a mote in my eye. Does that make sense? Okay. All right. Any other questions about James? Anything else? Microphone. Thank you. Go ahead.
So I was wondering, for chapter 4 and verse 15, it says, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that.
Yes.
And the way I hear people use that a lot is when their experiences don't line up to the word of God.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, well, the Lord doesn't will this. And so I don't know what to do with that.
Okay, so for example, let me see if I understand what you're saying. So for example, somebody says to you, oh, the Lord wills for me to be sick.
Yeah.
It's the Lord's will that I be sick, therefore I shouldn't be getting healed.
Yeah, and I don't want to boast about myself.
Okay, so here's what he's talking about when he talks about this. Because if we look at it, when he says, if we go up to, oh, goodness gracious. He's talking about the spirit lusting to envy, and he's talking about a difference in what we do, if you remember. And he says, there is one lawgiver, verse 12, who's able to save and destroy. Who are you that judges another? Remember, that's the context. We just talked about that quite a bit. That who are you that's making some determination about somebody else's life? But he's not talking about sin. Then when he says, go to now, you that say. Says, hearken unto what I'm telling you, you that say, I'm going to go do this. You need to have enough humility in your life that you stop with your self-proclamation. Right? Then he gets to, you ought to say, if the Lord will. He's very specific about the context of that. So if somebody quotes, they say, whoa, 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 whoa. That scripture very specifically is in the context of how you live your life day by day and what you're doing before God and your humility before Him. It's not about whether you're sick. Because later on in the same book, he says, is there any sick among you? Is there any sick? Are you an any? I'm one of any. Yes. You're sick. Let him call for the elders of the church, and the prayer of faith will save the sick, and if they've committed any sins, they shall be forgiven. That's what you do. Same book. Run over here and go, look, is any sick? Well, it's the Lord will. Good. My other favorite one for that is when the disciples come to Jesus and they go, this man who was born blind, did he sin or did his parents sin? They're trying to figure out why he was born blind because this seems awful unfair. So there must have been some horrible sin. Well, was it him or was it his parents? And Jesus, he didn't even give the question any deference. He just goes, no. Your premise was wrong. Your understanding was wrong. Completely wrong. Because it says the prayer of faith shall save the sick. And if any have sinned, their sins shall be forgiven them. It's not... There is not this direct understanding of you sin, you get a sickness. If you have a sickness, therefore you sinned. That is not true. The two are like Siamese twins from hell. They're always together many times. and many people that are sick need to have sins forgiven, but it says if. It's just like if any man sin. It's still an if. So you don't want to do what the disciples did. Immediately assumed, okay, there's a sickness. Man's born blind. Must be a sin. Is it his or his parents? Well, they missed the very point. It doesn't say that. Jesus said, no, no. But so the glory of God can be revealed. And he goes and heals the guy. All right? That's the only thing we know about sickness is not that we sit there and talk about it's the will of God, not the will of God, all that. It's so that God can receive glory in healing it. So you say, oh, really? The will of God is that you get healed. That's the will of God. If God wills, I'm going to tell you what his will is. He wants you to get healed. Are you sick? Call for the elders of the church, and the prayer of faith will save the sick. There you go. Simple enough. And you've got them. And they'll either accept it or reject it, because there's nothing they can do against the word of God. Does that help? All right. Praise the Lord. The Lord's so good. Any other questions? Especially about James or these things. Okay. Does anybody have any Bible question bugging you that you just want to see if we can, by the Holy Ghost, answer? Anything you've been reading that you're just wondering about? Or you guys just know all things? Holy Ghost been showing you everything? You understand them all? Okay. It's the opportunity. It's so much fun. I thought that was a hand, but it was just a knock out the fly. Okay. So then we're finished. Praise the Lord. He's so good. Now go forth, show no partiality, show no judgment of men, and love people with all your heart.